so amazing, so amazing. Your love for us is overwhelming. How awesome is our God?
So amazing, so amazing. Your love for us is overwhelming.
Welcome. This is Sunday School Lesson Preparation. I'm Pastor Jimmy Brown of the St. Luke Memorial Baptist Church in St. Louis, Missouri, thanking all of you, especially our subscribers, for being so consistent and being so supportive of the years that we have presented the Sunday School Lesson. Our lesson on this Sunday, which is July 28th, is Lesson 9. In this series. And the title of our lesson is Expectant Watchfulness. Expectant Watchfulness. The background scriptures for our study is the entire 130th number of Psalms. But our devotional reading is from Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 through 13. We'll be reading from the King James Version on our devotional message or devotional reading. Matthew chapter 25, verse 1. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight, there was a cry made, "Behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye out to meet him." Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said unto the wise, "Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out." But the wise answered, saying, "Not so, lest there be not enough for us and you. But go ye rather to them that sell, and buy for yourselves." And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgins, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he answered and said, "Verily I say unto you, I know you not. Watch therefore, for ye know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh. That's our devotional scripture, Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 through 13. Again, expectant watchfulness. Expectant watchfulness. Psalms 130, beginning at verse 1. Out of the depths have I cried unto thee, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let thine ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If thou, Lord, shouldest mark iniquities, O Lord, who shall stand? But there is forgiveness with thee, that thou mayest be feared. I wait for the Lord. My soul doth wait, and in his word do I hope. My soul waiteth for the Lord more than they that watch for the morning. I say more than they that watch for the morning. Let Israel hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is mercy. With him is plenteous redemption. And he shall redeem Israel from all iniquities. Our lesson aim for this particular lesson is to identify elements of cause and effect in the text. Number two, define the genre of lament using Psalms 130 as an example. And thirdly, personalize in writing one of the verses without changing the psalmist's original intent. The breakdown of our lesson is one address to the Lord, Psalms 130, verses 1 through 6. God listens, verses 1 through 2. God forgives, verses 3 through 4. And finally, waiting for God, verses 5 through 6. The second portion of our lesson is addressed to Israel, and that's verses 7 through 8 of Psalms 130. Hope in God, the emphasis of verse 7. Receive redemption is the emphasis of verse 8. So let's go get into this lesson so that we'll be able to share with those that come looking for the guidance and the direction and what it means to be prepared and be watchful enough to know when the season of preparation is. Psalms 130 is part of a cluster, usually called the Psalms of Ascent, or less often, the Pilgrimage Psalter. This includes Psalms 120 through Psalms 134. The Psalms in the group may have originated at different times and places, as would be true of a modern hymnal, but function together as songs for the pilgrims entering the Jerusalem temple in the period following the Babylonian exile. Yes, Psalms of Ascension, when they were going up to Jerusalem. These are some of the Psalms that is believed that they would be singing. The group of Psalms falls into three subgroups. Psalms 120 and 24, Psalms 125 through 29, and Psalms 130 through 34. The pilgrims sang them at different stops on the road from the Mount of Olives through the Kidron Valley and into the precincts around the temple itself. Psalms 130 in particular may have served as part of a night vigil as the pilgrims waited the dawn, which in turn would symbolize the dawning of God's light in their lives. As verse 6. Those hypotheses are reasonable but hard to prove. yet they would explain the varying moods of these psalms and their progressive closeness to the temple itself. More certain is that the psalms together address a wide range of concerns and moods. Together, they allow the worshiping community to express anxiety and hope. Praise God. Fear and trust. Sorrow and joy. That is, they held worshipers, they helped worshipers bring their entire lives to God, share their lives with each other, and eagerly await God's transforming work. Psalms 130 moves the pilgrims from the attitude of despair to one of supreme confidence in God's saving work. Hallelujah. When the one singing focuses on his own personal suffering, fear and sorrow can overtake faith. But when the focus shifts toward God's inclination to save and the consequent hope that the entire people may enjoy, the mood may change to hope. So it is here. He was trying to give them an attitude of hope as they approach the temple. The poem, though very short, moves in several steps from a statement of need addressed to God to an acknowledgement of God's mercy and confession of hope, to an address to all of Israel. Psalms 130 begins with a cry to God, as most laments do. Here, the attitude is one of deep need and expectation of help. It differs from some psalms of lament by being briefer and jumping to praise without much preparation. In these songs born of distress, the singer either promises to praise God or does so. The promise of the praise is born out of gratitude for God's generous response to the petition for help. Psalms 130 seems like a very condensed lament that shades into something different altogether. Perhaps that difference from other psalms reflects that one's placement in a larger group. It does not have to do all the work a normal lament does, because it does not stand alone. It's got Psalms 129, which describes long-standing attacks on faithful Israelites and expects God's deliverance, while Psalms 130 expresses contrition before God. Collectively, these psalms together position the one praying as someone in the correct spiritual position before God. And when we pray, we need to get ourselves in the correct spiritual position before God. Let's look at the first outline, which is Psalms 130, verses 1 through 6, and it addresses to the Lord. And first thing you need to know is God listens. Or you can even say God is listening. Verse 1 said, out of the depths have I cried unto thee, O Lord. This phrase, out of the depths, might be a shorter form of the phrase, the depths of the waters. Ezekiel chapter 27, 34. And in Psalm 69, verse 2, and in verse 14, and Isaiah 51 and 10 speaks of the depths of the sea. While the Hebrew word here translated depths only occurs in these instances in the Bible, images of the watery deep were frequently used as an image of danger or chaos. especially the horror of drowning. Additionally, the concept of depth is linked to Sheol, the place of the dead. Depth and Sheol should not be conflicted or conflated, but neither should the possible link between them be neglected. Like Jonah crying from the belly of the great fish, Jonah chapter 2, verses 2 through 5, the psalmist here speaks metaphorically of having descended to the realm of death, the Sheol, though not an equivalent of the place we would call hell. Sheol was under the earth and generally considered far from God's presence. No one worshiped God there. According to Psalms 88, 10 through 12, these characteristics of Sheol gives insight into what death entailed to ancient Israelites' way of thinking. The cry from the gates of the realm of death, Sheol itself, points to the many sorts of problems humans may face, including our mortality, proneness to sickness, as well as the hostile attitudes of wicked people, or the irresistible power of some historical or natural events. The depths may take many forms. From there, the psalmist now addresses God in hopes of being heard and saved. You can compare Psalm 49 and 15. A call asking God to listen comes early in the many of David's laments. The psalm before us is not attributed to David, nor is the request to hear repeated word for word, but each instance shares the idea that God will be inclined to listen, that the human being ought to seek God's attention, and that each supplicant may do so freely and in the company of others. We can seek his guidance. We can seek his way. The psalmist is not in danger of drowning and may not literally be about to die. But many different forms of suffering can feel like a death, from physical ailments to relational estrangements and beyond. In all circumstances, even as far from God as Israelites could imagine, at the bottom of a body of water, we can still call on the name of the Lord. Look at verse 2. Lord, hear my voice. Let thine ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication. The opening address to the Lord continues with a petition to listen. These two clauses express essentially the same thing, repeating both the sense of the verb hear and the direct object, my voice. This poetic device of synonymous literalism or parallelism reinforces the importance the psalmist places on receiving God's full attention. The second clause asks for tangible but unspecified expressions of God's favor. His care begins with listening attentively to the content of the supplication and acting to alleviate those specific concerns. As is common in Psalms, we do not know the specific occasion for writing, a feature of the poems that invites us to consider our own supplications. Similar language appears several times in Psalms of lament, Psalms 86 and 6, Psalms 140 and 6, Psalms 143:1, Psalms 28:6, for example, offers a counterpart to the request for God to hear by celebrating that God already had heard. All these psalms expect that God desires to listen to sincere desires for help, and that God will respond with speed and compassion. We do well to remember, however, that God's timing is not our own. 2 Peter 3:9. And a perceived lack of an answer from God does not mean he has not heard or has not intention of acting. That's when it comes in and says, wait on the Lord. God forgives. God hears. God forgives. If thou shouldest mark iniquities, O Lord, who shall stand? The psalmist affirmed God's mercy in the form of a question, and if remind him of his choice to exhibit mercy. God could obsess over human sin. God could keep meticulous tab on every stray thought, every stray word, every stray deed. A similar use of the verb mark appears 1 Samuel 1:12, which says that Eli marked Hannah's mouth when she prayed for a son. In the context of 1 Samuel, the verb suggests close observation, even as it does here. If God decides to mark iniquities, every one of them, every missed word, every misdeed, every action contrary to his word, the question is, who shall be able? And the answer is no one. Furthermore, a God who rigorously punished all evil immediately would leave no space for human survival. Who would survive such a God? The answer is nobody. But a God who ignored evil doing altogether would cause great harm to humanity as well. We might consider the fear of God's abandoning his people as exemplified in the Lamentations. The God of Israel, however, engages with human beings to reform their lives, not to destroy their lives. Sure, he could hold every one of us accountable and responsible for everything we see, think, or do. And I said, thank you for your mercy. Thank you that your new mercies help us. Thank you for your grace. The psalmist's question is not merely a theoretical discussion of divine mercy. Mentioning sin also likely touches on the psalmist's reasons for writing: to repent of sinful behavior and to seek God's forgiveness. Amen. Repent of sinful behavior and to seek God's forgiveness. The psalmist assumes that God delights in forgiveness and the repair of human life that it makes possible. Ezekiel 33:11, Acts 2:17-39. By appealing to God's mercy, the person praying also commits to reform. Amen. You got to change. If you want to appeal to his mercy, you got to be ready to change. A lot of people beg God for mercy, but God never sees a change. Verse 4 says, but there is forgiveness with thee that thou mayest be feared. But ties this verse closely to verse 3, implying a consequence of closely related events. the experience or even observation of God's forgiveness and its consequences for human life create a sense of awe in the impressionable human. Here the psalmist acknowledges of God's inclination toward mercy becomes clear. But the consequence of faults may seem odd at first. How does the reality of forgiveness create an off-field sense of fear? Contrary to possible view that God's hatred of sin or ferocity toward evil will so terrify people that they will live better lives. This verse suggests that God's mercy towards sinners inspires them, should inspire them to honor him more. Instead of being mired in sins, paralyzed to close or to choose or do better, forgiveness creates a new path. Divine gentleness with the people inspires awe, in part because it seems so different from human inclinations toward one another. In contrast to the pitiless ways in which we often respond to mistreatment or wrongdoing, God exercises mercy. Some of us want to get even with everybody that ever thought of doing anything to them. But look at God's mercy. Look at God's mercy. If it wasn't for the mercy of God, God could pile up the evidence of our guilt too. But he chooses instead, somebody ought to say thank you, to throw out the evidence against us and to forgive us. Are there any wrongdoings that you continue to keep records of? What prevents you from throwing out these records as God did for you? Verse 5 and 6 talk about waiting for God. Verse 5a say, I wait for the Lord, my soul doth wait. The Hebrew word translated here for soul has a more robust meaning than we might consider in English. Ancient Israelites did not believe in a soul that merely inhabited the body like Greek thinking. Instead of a divide between body and soul, the Israelites thought of the human being as an integrated whole, a body and soul unity. The soul was the animating force, the piece of the body that made a person alive. This integration of body and soul remains central even in Christianity, which rests on the hope of our bodily resurrection rather than the immortality of a disembodied spirit or soul. It's saying my soul doth wait, then the psalmist claims to anticipate God's saving work with every fiber of his being. The psalmist's faith involves an orientation to a future in which the problems of the moment finally finds a solution. Verse 5b, and in his word do I hope. In his word do I hope. The hope here is a synonym for waiting on God. We never hope in vain when we place our hope in his promises. God's word refers here not to the law as it might, but to his promise of salvation given to Abraham, which becomes the focus of the faithful person's life. Having confidence in that promise shapes behavior, for a lifetime as well. Verse 6 says, my soul waiteth for the Lord more than they that wait for the morning. I say more than they that wait and watch for the morning. This verse repeats more than they that watch for the morning for rhythmical purposes. We might recognize this convention in our hymns. The repetition also expresses the intensity of waiting for God's saving act. The waiting involves a person's entire being. What this particular phrase means, however, is less than obvious. The emphasis could be on waiting at a specific time during the night, or it could be emphasizing they, the sentinels, who are watching. In either case, an analogy is drawn. Just as nighttime sentries eagerly await the dawn and the relative safety of daytime, so does the one praying wait for a new day in which God is going to act. Once again, the psalmist's faith requires hope in God's future actions. The last part of our lesson, part two, addresses to Israel, verses 7 through 8 of Psalms 130. And he addresses them by saying, hope in the Lord. Hope in God. Let Israel hope in God. Hallelujah. For with the Lord, there is mercy. In the last two verses, the psalm shifts focus from an individual psalmist to the whole community. This sort of shift frequently occurs in the Psalms of Lament, but this one lacks any transition as the psalm tunes or turns from the address to God to the address to the people. The hope, especially in God's mercy, that the psalmist expressed for his personal circumstances is prescribed for the gathering community. Verse 7b says, and with him is plenteous redemption. Hallelujah. The Hebrew behind this phrase, difficult sometimes to be translated. One reason for that is the scarcity of biblical uses of the precise Hebrew word translated redemption. Translated sever and redeem. However, the related verb is more common, which gives us confidence that redemption is the appropriate translation. While we don't often think of it this way, redemption is a legal metaphor. In ancient Israel, the term often applied to the purchase of slaves to free them. The language is prevalent in texts describing God's liberation of Israel from Egyptian bondage. Here, however, the liberation does not involve political oppression, or at least not just that, but the oppression of human sin in all its forms. The psalm anticipates God's acting to free Israel from sin's power. This redemption is the ultimate fulfillment of God's ancient covenant with the ancestors. Receive the redemption, and he shall redeem Israel. Verse 8. From all his iniquities. As laments often do, the psalm ends with an expression of deep trust in God. This ending repositions the whole poem because it moves readers from focusing on the individual to God's care for the whole people. In God's great mercy lies hope for Israel and everyone within it. This psalm probably lies behind the promise of the angel to Joseph in Matthew 1:21, "Thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." For Matthew, Jesus became the sign, an instrument of God's redemption of Israel and to the larger world. There's a tight connection between the individual experience and the community's proclamation. The people of Israel were the community whom God rescued from evil in all its manifestations, of which we are the spiritual descendants. The people announced and celebrated the good news that such deliverance had come, had occurred, and they sought more of it. And of course, that understanding also applies to the church. It applies to the community grafted into Israel. We also experience both as individuals and as a community the power of God's forgiveness, which we imitate in our dealings with others. We ought to thank him, for he has bestowed upon us his redemption. Psalms 130 speaks to faith that involves waiting for God's grace to make itself known. During such a time, the person may doubt God's ability, God's willingness to save, question the integrity of other human beings, even lose self-respect. Waiting for salvation challenges every fiber of a person's being. Yet, that challenge itself strengthens faith in the long run. This Psalms make clear, trust in God does not come without some doubts. Will God listen? Is a question that many have asked themselves. Biblical faith is not a Pollyanna attitude about life. It is realistic and honest about hardship, yet it does not remain there. The spiritual challenge we face, the depths, becomes opportunities, hallelujah, for grace. Therefore, learning the discipline of waiting is part of learning to live with God and all others who are also awaiting God's help. This psalm, in short, exposes an important truth about human beings, our profound need and our profound desire for God's presence. As part of a community of pilgrims seeking God's presence, the faithful person can speak to God even in the most desperate moments of life. The communal worship of the Israelite community acknowledged that fact. God does not skimp on acts that will benefit human beings, but rather frequently engages in them. Worship is in the community, still reminds us of God's almighty acts. May we in our darkest moments and in the grasp of sin, the sins that don't want to let us go, cry out to our God. Heed the call to hope in his saving works. Cry out to God. Believe God. Trust God. He will forgive. He will deliver. He will heal. Thought to remember, faith celebrates our hope in God's forgiveness and calls others to do the same. Our hope can impact the hope of others. That is our Sunday school lesson for this Sunday. thank God for you. And may you be blessed by the word and the promises that are made by God. God bless you.
You rescued us. How awesome.